There can be few organisations that have had a bigger impact on all levels of world history than the Jesuits. This film seeks to look at the British Jesuits, about what they do and the way in which they operate. It's a film that may begin here at St. Ignatius' birthplace in Spain, but it will take us far further than the shores of Europe.
The only question for us is, what are we being called to do today in the service of the Church?
He talks about being a contemplative in action. So it's not a question of long hours of prayer.
It's extremely important that if somebody of no religion at all, or somebody who is a convinced and anti-Catholic Protestant, meets us and realizes we're not dinosaurs, then good is being done.
We're not monks, you know, we don't have a routine timetable. So you fit Mass in either early in the morning or later in the evening, or often it's part of the school day.
We begin our journey here in North London, where Jesuits have gathered at the Church of St. Ignatius. They're here for the ordination to the priesthood of these three men. It's one stage of many in their mission as members of the Society of Jesus, which could take them in any number of directions.
The Jesuit way of life and the prospect of being a Jesuit priest for me has given me a level of contentment which I suspect people being called to marriage or whatever would also have for themselves.
Even at the age of 8 or 9 I thought I wanted to be a priest. I thought God, that was what God wanted me to do. And it's strange that sort of since that age that sort of feeling has never left me.
Are the moments when you think, what am I doing?
Oh, yes, 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 yes. Yes, I wouldn't say frequently, because there's always something that I'm doing which I actually find quite interesting, or there seems to be some value or some sense to it.
In some ways, I don't know what it's going to be like. I mean, I've had a lot of training, a lot of preparation, and you'd hope that after 10 years I'd be ready for that. But you know, there's a sense of stepping out into the unknown. Ignatius's great achievement was to bring God out of the monastery. He recognized that God was at work in the world. And Jesuits, you know, always have been sent out into the world to live in the world. Your Lord!
Education, it's something the Jesuits have always been committed to. They've got 9 schools in Britain, and Dushan Cruz's first posting after his ordination is to one of them as chaplain. Wimbledon College, a comprehensive boys' school with over 1,500 pupils.
This is a group of people very diverse at a key moment in their lives that we should be trying to help them in some way to have an experience of God. That's not just through prayer, but it's also through this experience of community. And how do we organise a school community in a way that the weakest are looked after? How do we organise a school community in a way that each person sort of finds their talents and makes them flourish, and then puts them at the service of other people?
But
250 miles north and the setting at Stonyhurst College, a Catholic independent school, may be rather different, but the challenges are much the same. And here there's quite a history for the lay headmaster to build upon, dating back to 1593.
How do you measure ethos in, for example, 1850 as opposed to 1960 as opposed to 2006? All you can say is that I think that it's been made more explicit rather than being totally implicit, and that it's witnessed in the lives of the children and what they think about, and that's something which is noted by all impartial visitors and observers to the college.
What do you know about St. Ignatius?
He was born in Loyola. Yeah, he fought for Pamplona in the Basque country, and then he got his legs blown off. He had them reset, and then he decided to go in the way of God and went to... he went to see the Black Madonna and wrote the...
Spiritual exercises.
Hello, have a nice weekend. See you on Monday.
Jesuit schools in Britain cover the whole spectrum of Catholic education. Here at St. Aloysius College in Glasgow, they cater for well over 1,000 boys and girls from the age of 3 to 18.
What makes a Jesuit institution different in terms of school is they articulate it very clearly. In a Jesuit institution, it is very explicit. So I think that's the fundamental difference between a Catholic school, where a lot of these values are implicit. In a Jesuit school, you make all those things that you might take for granted very explicit.
I took a disabled child to Lourdes, because there's a Lourdes pilgrimage that Father Bishop runs, and for a week, and it was fantastic.
And what do you get out of something like that?
Well, a lot of things, I suppose. You build up a relationship with your child, which you can carry on for the rest of the year, which is great because you can help their families and, you know, respite and have a great time as well.
Every couple of Tuesdays you go out to a special needs school where there's kind of disabled children, where you just talk to them, play with them and help them with their homework.
This is humanity as you find it in this area, and it's important that we engage with the boys and their families here, whoever they are. Our job is to engage with people in the places they find themselves. The first Jesuits were in the marketplaces talking to people. They didn't confine themselves to the churches. And in many ways, schools and places like this are the marketplaces of today.
The whole Jesuit ethos thing works at different levels. Yes, we can point here to the extraordinarily generous commitment of the kids to, their charitable activities. But I think at a deeper level, you can also say, you know, what's happening in their prayer life? And they are, without always explicitly knowing it, being introduced to an Ignatian way.
The idea of having a perfect school is never going to happen. Like, we're teenagers just like everyone else. But there is a genuine sense of responsibility of reaching out to the wider world.
There are so many labels that are attached to Jesuit education that are familiar to a lot of people within Jesuit schools. And I mean, for example, things like for the greater glory of God, or men and women for others. Now, these are quite attractive labels, but when you actually say, well, how are you going to make that happen in the school, that's a more complicated thing to talk about. And the thing I worked on was the word gratitude.
That those angels, those messengers of God, they're you and they're me. That when God wants to speak to us, he speaks to us through one another. What did St. Ignatius say? That we should live each day as if it were? Wonderful. What a model student. We should live every day as if it was our last.
Do you think there's a problem that Jesuits get wrapped up in schools a little bit too much?
I think that could be the case. We've traditionally gone to the places where there's been the greatest need. And I think there are two things which need to be done. Either to constantly be aware of the new challenges which need to be faced so that those apostolates are developing. but then also to have perhaps the courage to say, well, we've done what we were asked to do. There are other people now doing that job very well, perhaps even better than ourselves, and now we need to respond to those needs which aren't being met by other people. And that's the kind of tough decision I think that provincials and his advisors need to make.
I never cared much for moonlit skies. I never winked back at fireflies.
It would be wrong to assume Jesuit education is reserved just for the classroom. Far from it. The order's pretty innovative at bringing the gospel message to the people, wherever they may be. And tonight, they're down the local.
Oh, I think the point of a night like this is to give people an opportunity together to explore their faith and some of the key elements in it, some of the key questions in it. I think it's a very congenial way of doing it, because rather than it being too formal, it's actually saying the faith is something that's part of our lives, it's part of our normal conversations. And so friends come together in this very congenial setting, and it's an opportunity to share and to talk and to explore.
Characteristic of the Jesuits is mission, going out into new territories. And these days, that includes embracing new media, bringing God to the iPod generation.
There are probably things on my mind as I try to pray right now. Things bothering me, worrying me, things I've got to do. Those hassles and concerns may be important, but for these few minutes, can I just put them on one side?
It's 10 minutes of peace during the day. Like if you're sitting on the train, surrounded by people you don't know, going to work, you can just put your MP3 player on and just have 10 minutes of prayer. 10 minutes with God, really, when you're just in the middle of your day-to-day life.
I think it's amazing. I had this image of the Jesuits stuck in the 16th century, Counter-Reformation stuff. And now they're using this up-to-date technology and iPods. And the slogan as well, Pray As You Go, it's so catchy and up-to-date, it's great.
I think it's innovative and it is important. And of course, it's part and parcel of what the society has always done. The society has always really gone to where people are and tried to engage them in the circumstances in which we find them.
Traditional expression of mission is still evident in South America. Guyana's been part of the British province for 150 years. Whether working in the remote interior of the country or in the cities, the work is the same, helping people to find God.
It is very good here to help the people, and they need this kind of help.
We have here also children who are not going to school. Their parents cannot afford to send them to school, so they come here and they get a free teaching.
Centers like this, the Guyana Human Development Center, is a very good thing that we are present among non-Christians and Christians of all denominations as a presence of the Catholic Church to all people.
The Jesuits' work is diverse, always being adapted to different times, circumstances, or cultures. At its root, though, is going where the needs are greatest, something even Mother Teresa didn't initially recognize.
We went and sat down in a little parlor, and she suddenly walked in. I wasn't expecting even to meet her, but she walked in and sat down. And the first thing she said to me was, "You Jesuits should continue looking after the rich, for this is what you're good at." And I said, "Mother, how could you possibly say that? Because I'm here to try and help Jesuits work for the poor." And she said, no, you can leave that to me and my sisters. You stay with the rich." Well, as a result of that, we had quite an argument, quite a discussion. But I gave her the text of our little decree 4, which talks about justice. She took it and promised to read it. The next time I met her was in Rome. She said, "I've read your decree 4. And I now understand what you're trying to do. And I hope you Jesuits continue working for the poor and for people who need justice."
So at my show on Monday, I
someday you'd be on your way to better things. It's not about your makeup or how you try to shape up to these tiresome paper dreams. Paper dreams, honey. So now you pour your heart out, you're telling me you're far out, not about to lie down for your cause. But you don't pull my strings, cause I'm a better man, moving on to better things.
Guyana's national Catholic newspaper was established by the Jesuits over 100 years ago. It's been a voice for the people through difficult and often violent times. For speaking out against injustice, some Jesuits have paid a high price.
Father Dark was a part-time photographer for the Catholic Standard in the 1970s. And there was an incident where government supporters were breaking up an anti-government rally, and Father Dark went to get pictures of this atrocity and to tell the world about what was going on in Guyana. And he was trampled, beaten, and stabbed to death in July 1979. He was one of the first Jesuits that suffered this badly in this country. He gave his whole life for the sake of press freedom.
Well, this is the border where Guyana meets Suriname, and we can't actually go any further than this. But the Jesuits do. They go by boat at least once a week down the River Corentine into the interior.
The Catholic message and the Catholic way isn't to come, in one sense, from outside with lots of things from outside and to try and tell Amerindian people that they should change and they should become like the outside. It is to try and witness to the fact, to the presence of God within that group of people.
This is just a small example of the way in which the Jesuits operate. A bakery, which the order helped set up, allowing the Amerindians to become less reliant on overpriced bread from outside the region.
We gotten four or five women to come together who knew how to bake in commercial quantities, and we used to break 600 loaves a week.
And it's a nice gate, isn't it?
Going where the needs are greatest means that some Jesuits are required to work in parishes. Bob Barrow and Derek Maitland are both parish priests in East Guyana.
Sent to Teresa of the Missions. We've got Jesus, the Sacred Heart, up there, Lord. We've got all the Stations of the Cross. And we have... When I came out here in 63, there were over 60 Jesuits in Guyana. And the bishop was a Jesuit. And the provincial and bishop and all that ran things. They said, you do this, so I went to try to do that. And they said, well, you're no good at doing that, we'll move you somewhere else. Well, I was quite happy with that.
A bishop might be forgiven if he's thought, well, the best thing is he's got to find priests to man all his parishes. But as Jesuits, I think, we would be looking at that, but also looking at other things. Perhaps other orders are called more to contemplation, to prayer. We are called to that, but we are called to do it very much in the hub of activity. The phrase we use is to be contemplatives in action.
It's amazing, I don't know how they put so many people in the back of this king.
How many?
Well, about 20-something. What they do is the bigger people get in first, then the youths get in there, and then the little children on top of them. It's amazing how they manage. I know so many good Jesuits, so really wonderful people. The essence of being a good Jesuit is the love of Jesus. The love of Jesus.
Parish work is pretty similar wherever you travel in the world. Here in South Africa, the other region that's part of the British province, the Jesuits are responsible for caring for people in some of the poorest parishes in the country, such as here at St. Martin de Porres in Soweto. Soweto remains synonymous with the fight against apartheid in South Africa, and many can clearly recall the events of June 1976 when students rose against government oppression. Soweto paints a more colourful picture today, and the challenges of running a parish here 30 years on are rather different.
It's been a very busy day. I got up at 6 to lock up the big dogs, which we use for security. And then before 7 o'clock, I had a message on the phone to say that one of the parishioners had died. And then the young adults were here at 8:30 to start a retreat day. At 9 o'clock, a funeral began. And we went to bury that man, got back here in time for a late lunch, continued with the young adult day of prayer, and now we're talking with the youth group and we have confessions in about an hour's time. I don't think that all Jesuits ought to be in parishes, and I don't think all Jesuits should be in a parish at some stage, no. But I think it is good for us as a group to always have a few people in parish work, because it helps to keep us in touch with what's going on at ordinary parish level.
These people are part of our lives, they're part of the parish, they're here, they're roundabout. Most of the businesses roundabout wish they'd go away. I'm told frequently that if we didn't feed them, they wouldn't be here. This, of course, is untrue. If we didn't feed them, they would be here, but they'd be dead in the doorways. And so it's a tremendously important part of what we do.
We're basically third and fourth year medical students. We come after class to the church and obviously refer patients to surrounding clinics and hospitals for more appropriate care if that's what they need.
I don't see the parish work as boring or anything. I mean, it fires me up and I love it. I mean, I'm probably in my element working in the parish, so I'm thoroughly enjoying it. And I think that, you know, the work we do here is missionary, especially, for example, people on the streets. Some of them, you know, are people of other faiths, people who have never heard, perhaps, you know, about what the Catholic Church is even, that come to us for help.
The township of Nyanga is just 20 minutes from Cape Town's manicured lawns and golf courses, but this tough territory isn't on the tourist trail. The Dominican nuns have left after one of them was shot in the chest, but Jesuit Jerry Lorimer, now in his 90s, remains as the parish priest.
You see, we have these bars across the doors because we had break-ins, so we have to have something solid to prevent that happening. That's because you're so generous.
Jerry delivers weekly communion to parishioners 2 week to make it to his Sunday Mass.
It's all yourself. We've just been to this house where a young chap of 22 was stabbed to death. This is happening constantly. Yeah. So there's a lot of violence among them.
It may seem like another country, but we're a stone's throw from Nyanga. Welcome to the University of Cape Town, where the Catholic chaplain is a Jesuit priest. The contrast with the township couldn't be more vivid, but the Jesuits embrace the diversity.
We let the different activities simply fit together as a whole. We're not quite sure sometimes quite what the whole looks like, but it makes for very interesting discussion and very interesting conversations in the community. You know, if I ask Jerry, what was it like in Nyanga, and he says, what are you doing at UCT? And then somebody else says, well, actually I was in the hospital, and somebody says, I've got to go away now, I've got an article to finish. You know, there's a certain kind of reflective energy about that.
Back in Britain, the Jesuits have a substantial commitment to higher education and have university colleges in both London and here in Oxford.
That's Greek, yes, and I've already published a translation of the New Testament, and the publisher asked me to complete that with doing the Old Testament, which will take a very, very long time.
How long is a long time?
I've told him it'll be the rest of my life. I came to Oxford intending to become a lawyer and a barrister, and quite to my astonishment, at a particular moment that I can date to within about half an hour, I suddenly realised that the only thing I can do and be happy was join these Jesuits. And that was 40 years ago, and I've seen no reason to change my mind since then. And in difficult times, when occasionally I thought I ought to get a real job and get married, it was that moment that kept me going. You ask about education or indoctrination. Well, if it's education, then it isn't indoctrination. And my sense of Jesuit education is that we always encourage people to think for themselves. And sometimes the results are disconcerting. But you can't combine thinking for yourself with indoctrination.
A significant proportion of the most gifted young people in the country come for 3 years of their lives. They are taught by a wide variety of interesting people. And if we are at least able to have conversations in those circles, we stand some chance of influencing people whom we otherwise couldn't touch.
Did you say I've got a lot to learn?
Heathrop College, part of the University of London, is a major educational work of the British Jesuits, providing a range of courses in theology and philosophy. With students from wide-ranging backgrounds, it's a convivial place for discussion.
The Jesuits are extraordinary in being willing to put their primary, tertiary educational activity into the University of London, with all that means in terms of academic excellence. And I think there is no other religious organisation in the world that would do something quite so bold.
The sky's a blackboard high above you, and if a shooting...
One of the things that we try to do here is to enable people to get a perspective on how the culture has already shaped them and is shaping them, in order, if you like, to be able to get a perspective on what the real questions are that people have. And the real questions are always about meaning, purpose, and the value of human existence.
Heathrop acts as a hub between religions, but the discussions are by no means reserved for seminars like this. They take the Jesuits to places where some might not expect to see them.
What I need to be able to do to develop good interfaith relations is just find ways of getting into the community and engaging in some sort of friendly conversation. Once you've got in and you've got some reason to get in, all sorts of things can happen.
Michael is on the front line of interreligious relations and he regularly shares his experiences at Heathrop.
There's just... Think for a moment about the great story of the Ramayana, the story of Rama, of Sita, and of Lakshman.
Michael asks the gathering to deliver Christian messages of peace to the Hindus and Muslims of Southall.
It's the Jamia Masjid, which is the oldest mosque in Southall. Okay? If you look just up on the other side of Southall, number two, at the top of West End Road, is the Abu Bakr Mosque, okay? In the first place, it's a matter of preparing the ground, which will allow people a face to get together, talk to each other, learn from each other, I hope, build up a decent, coherent community which crosses all sorts of faith boundaries. That's what our mission is.
Visiting mosques, teaching Greek, building churches, influencing the rich to care for the poor. What inspires such diversity? It's time to find out. Pamplona is significant as the place where the story of the Jesuits begins. Ignatius was a noble soldier fighting against the French when something went horribly wrong.
It was at exactly this spot that in May 1521, Ignatius was wounded by a shot that ripped through his right leg and nearly killed him.
Out of action, his friends carried him the long distance back to his castle at Loyola, where he was left to recuperate. It's a little grander these days, but the original tower where Ignatius lay is still here. He was a romantic at heart, and as he recovered, wanted the 16th century equivalent of a few Jilly Cooper novels to read. Sadly, there weren't any, and he was offered two books, one on the life of Jesus, the other on the lives of the saints.
Well, this is what we've come to Loyola for, to find the room where St. Ignatius had his conversion, where he read those books about Jesus and the lives of the saints, and he changed his life forever.
Ignatius was convinced that his future should be devoted to God, and he attracted like-minded friends. One, St. Francis Xavier, lived in the same region of Spain, and his spectacular castle still attracts thousands of visitors each year. With other companions in 1540, they persuaded the Pope to let them start a new religious order. The Society of Jesus, working in the world for the service of others. Ignatius's hallmark was his spiritual exercises, a kind of multi-gym for the soul, aimed at helping people get closer to God. And Jesuit centers across the country offer retreats and courses in the spiritual exercises to a wide range of people.
No, I think sometimes, you know, we talk about Jesuit spirituality or Ignatian spirituality or Benedictine spirituality, and I think, oh, what the hell is that? I mean, what does it mean? And we were watching The Monastery on television a while back and thinking, this is really good, and it's a really good program, and look at what people are getting out of it. And also, just at one level, how completely not us it is.
What's the difference?
It's this belief that Ignatius has that God is at work in the world, everywhere. And that if you look and if you reflect on your own experience, you'll find that God. And that God will have something to say to you.
Faith pours from your walls, drowning your calls. I've tried to hear pure timing.
A few years ago, we were recognizing that some of the people who came here were really seeking what God was doing in their lives, but weren't particularly comfortable with traditional Christian imagery and iconography. So we came up with this room, the creation room, which, as you can see, is simply nature. You can either see this as, if you like, a beginning stage. They come here, they feel comfortable with this, and gradually over their time they come to a deeper, more traditional faith. Or else you can say, no, this is one way of finding God. If somebody's really in touch with creation and in their own lives with what's most truly life-giving, they're in touch with what I would call God.
Faith pours from your walls, pure timing.
The current popularity of Jesuit spirituality or Ignatian spirituality is it's very accessible to people. You can take on parts of it or the whole of it, but that sense of, if you like, the tagline of finding God in all things means that people can use this spirituality in their normal everyday life. It's not something you necessarily go away for or you separate yourself from the world. You're very much trying to live a relationship with Christ in the world.
Tomorrow we've got a weekend for gay and lesbian Christians in.
Would you consider that to be quite modern?
I suppose the particular work with lesbian and gay people would be sort of something that we've only been doing for 10 or 15 years. But one of the things that Jesuits were founded for was to go where the need was greatest. And part of that, where the need was greatest, was to reach out to people who were on the edges of the church one way or the other.
Life as a Jesuit is both varied and challenging, from schools and universities to retreat centres and remote parishes, and it's a vocation that can be difficult at times.
I think it does get lonely at times, and sometimes you do feel isolated, but I would think that that's also true for any walk of life.
I can't say that sometimes the illusion of, you know, how green it is on the other side doesn't occur to me. But no, I don't have any regrets about becoming a Jesuit.
I think it's not about numbers, you know. I want to believe that the Catholic Church offers a quality of life that is second to none.
Got the stuff you're telling me and anyone your heart.
This is enough. A wonderfully challenging life, a life in which you can offer all that you have for God's glory and the service of people. To be able to love and to serve is one of the most beautiful things one can do with one's life.
To put up a fight, you don't have to always be right.
If we were frightened of going too far, we would certainly be letting down the Lord.
For you. By engaging with people of other faiths, learning from them, you learn an awful lot about your own faith.
Listen.
Jesuits are much more focused on what the task is.
Do you think St. Ignatius would be proud of the Jesuits today?
I would love to ask him about this. I think most Jesuits today would be very uncomfortable if they were to meet Ignatius. I think he was a very difficult person sometimes to be with, as well as very inspirational.
Start putting the marks down.
If I had to characterise the Jesuits, I would say that I've found acceptance of lay ministry among the Jesuits that I've not found elsewhere.
Would St. Ignatius be proud of the Jesuits of Guyana today? I would say yes.
What Jesuit education is saying to you is, look, think things through for yourself.
What Ignatius did is help one person speak heart to heart to God.
While the ability of the Jesuits to continue St. Ignatius' legacy depends on new vocations, the partnership between themselves and laypeople is of vital importance. Their adaptability is clearly one of their strengths, and a modern collaborative approach will be crucial in their continuing mission.